I am Centennial's second mayor. Since we are a fairly new city, only about 13 years old, I was elected in 2009 and started in 2010, and I'm up for re-election this year. The city of Centennial is 100,000 people. We were the largest single incorporation in U.S. history of a city, of 100,000, and we still hold that record today. Most cities start small and build. We started large and stayed that way. So we're rather proud of that because we're all about self-determination. My history with the city that brought me to being mayor was I had been part of the formation process, worked on the campaign for that as just a little doobie at the grocery store holding up a sign or getting, you know, literature passed out, and then went on to do a number of our task forces and our committees to write many of the documents throughout our city's history. And the most recent was our Home Rule Charter. So when the city did a Home Rule Charter and went to ballot, I chaired that commission and decided that after writing all these things, it would be nice to get to vote on some of them. So I actually ran for council back in 05 and did not win, and then decided to run for mayor. So things come full circle in an interesting way. In my private life, my husband and I have owned a small business for the last 28 years. We have a cardboard box and shipping supply company and a recycling company. And then I do special district management as sort of my day job right now. So water, sanitation districts, metro districts. I'm sort of like the city manager for a special district. So I do that management. So that's kind of my story. And two kids, two granddaughters. If any of you are on Facebook with me, you know that's pretty much what gets posted is granddaughters.
I have a background in government, having served at all levels, federal, state, county, special district, and city. Been 24 years with Uncle Sam on the federal side, and chaired the dealer board of Motor Vehicle Dealer Board on the state side. Served on a water and sand district, Castlewood, on the special district side, and started on city council. I actually did the building authority and some assessment centers for the police department before I started on council in 2003, became mayor pro tem 2005. And when another great lady in politics, Nancy Sharp, was elected to county commissioner, and she resigned to take that appointment in January 3rd of 2011, and the council elected me to replace her. And then in November of 2011, I was elected for a four-year term unopposed, and I get to go possibly in 2015 for one more term. I too have two children and two grandchildren and two granddogs, and I have a wife of who has made only one mistake in her life, and you know what that is. otherwise, she's got really good judgment. And today marks the 47th year that she made that mistake.
Aw, congratulations.
Doug?
My name is Doug Tisdale, and I serve as the mayor of Cherry Hills Village. I was elected as mayor in April of last year. I served on the city council from 2000 until 2008, and then I was term limited off of council and sat out for a while, and then decided to run for mayor, as that was the stone left unturned, and I have had a very enjoyable time as mayor. I will point out to you that since being elected mayor of Cherry Hills Village, in September of last year, the Wall Street Journal reported that we were the number one best suburb of America to live in. In December of last year, Forbes magazine reported that we were the 46th priciest zip code for residential real estate in the United States of America. In March of this year, the Forbes magazine reported that the U.S. Census Bureau had determined that we were the sixth most affluent city in the United States of America. In April of this year, the Wall Street Journal published a full-page story on Cherry Hills Village in the real estate section, talking about the homes and the nature of Cherry Hills Village. As I've pointed out to real estate broker friends, I've done my job. And I'm not saying that I caused any of those stories to appear in the paper, well, except for the April 12th story in the Journal. But I will say that none of them appeared before I was elected mayor. And it's a great opportunity to help a wonderful city that is 6.5 square miles with 6,100 people who live in 2,100 single-family residential homes. As you know, we have nothing but single-family residences in Cherry Hills in terms of dwelling units. We have 8 churches, 6 small businesses that are in Cherry Hills Village and not in Englewood, and we have 4 clubs and 3 schools. And that pretty much defines Cherry Hills Village. We are a terrific proponent of regionalism in the area. I love to see the new businesses come into Centennial and Englewood and Littleton and Greenwood Village, because I know that those cities will benefit from those new businesses. I know that our residents will benefit from having opportunities present that were not otherwise available to them. I also know that the people who work at those businesses will want to live in Centennial or Englewood or Greenwood or Littleton. But I know that the people who own those businesses will want to live in Cherry Hills Village. So we're very happy to see that happen. Personally, I'm a lawyer, went to the University of Michigan Law School, have been in private practice in the law here in Colorado. For 16 years, I was with Brownstein Hyatt, and for a number of years, I was with Baker & Hostetler. I have my own firm, but I've actually been on sabbatical for the past couple of years because I've been working so hard at being the mayor of a very discerning population that demands great attention from their mayor. I was married for 31 years. My wife passed away in January of 2004, and I have 4 grown children and 1 grandchild. I am not up for re-election this year, which is why my remarks are actually shorter than they would otherwise be. But my passion for real estate stems from my father. My father, Chuck Tisdale, was a real estate salesman and broker all of his life, and sold real estate, recreational real estate, for a long time at Lake Havasu City, Arizona, and Fountain Hills, Arizona, and other places, but also did residential real estate in California, Colorado, and Michigan. And so I have a tremendous affection for realtors and for all associated with them and for the great work that you do. Thank you.
I'm Debbie Brinkman, mayor of Littleton. I'm in my second term as mayor. And I'm in my sixth year on council. I serve the District 4 on council, which is the southwest corner of the community. I actually have no political background and came into this. I was a NIMBY. I fought a rezone in my community, and after that win, I decided that I didn't particularly care for the representation on council, so 3 of us came out of the community, just plucked right off of our Barca loungers, and ended up winning, and kind of turned things over and turned things around for a while. So that's kind of my experience. I'm learning as I go. I will say, Doug touched on the regionalism. I was here, I think, I was pro tem before being mayor. I was pro tem for 2 years. And both of those years, I think, I was here on the panel. And I was really very unsure of what I was doing, talking like a mayor. And didn't really know the other mayors that were up here. And what has happened since becoming mayor is this incredible opportunity to become part of this great group of mayors. And the ones that are sitting up here, we are truly, I think that the region is truly blessed because of our ability to work well together. We genuinely like each other. We care about each other. We care about each other's communities. We get together for mayor things, the Metro Mayor Caucus and different things. We're on different committees throughout the region that we serve. But we also get together, the six of us plus Dallas Hall from Sheridan, and we have our own social activities that we do in order to just kind of stay in touch and stay in community with each other. And that, to me, is really what starts to make the big difference when you're talking about different communities in different areas, particularly our region. The Denver metropolitan area is very fortunate and very blessed that we all do have that strong relationship. But it serves everybody well because you don't see that type of fighting. You don't see the arguing. You see the support and encouragement and the strength that comes from that. So I think that's been one of the biggest thrills. Grew up in Denver native. I moved to Littleton about 12 years ago. And I spent about 24 years in advertising and marketing. I worked as a marketing director in a number of businesses and then at advertising agencies, ran accounts. And I decided, a friend of mine told me to retire early and often. So I retired from that and I started my own business doing organizing and interior design, and I've been doing that now. I'm in my 9th year of doing that. And I have plans within the next couple months to retire from that and have another career on the horizon, which I will announce at some point. I'm very excited about that, though. So I get bored. I just keep moving on. So I have my whole family is here. My father also is a realtor. And he worked at Gage Rubber Company for about 30 years building fan belts. And when was very strong in the union at that point in the 60s, 70s, 80s. And when they'd go on strike, he'd run off and sell a couple, three, four houses. They'd go back to work. He'd get back. Huh. That's when you could, pop in and sell for you. So he kept his license active. When he finally retired, he went full into real estate and is slowly kind of weaning back out of that and I think starting to consider enjoying some retirement. So I'm his worst client ever. And, I don't know what's wrong with seeing 30 or 40 houses before you make a decision. And I have two sisters. One's a chief in the Navy, and the other one is a deputy director with Denver Public Schools. And niece and a nephew, one's going into the Marines, and the other's a lacrosse champ over at Arapahoe High School. And I guess if you follow me on Facebook, I also have a dog, Willie, friendly little dog, Humane Society adoptee.
My name's Randy Penn. I'm the mayor of the city of Englewood. My speech started out at good morning. The other mayor started talking, it's good afternoon. Doug started talking, so I will say good evening to all of you. So we can get that taken care of. Really good. It's nice that Cherry Hills Village is our suburb. We'd love to have them as a suburb, and it's always nice to have them there so we can get going. I don't know how I got here. This is kind of strange. I taught school for 38 years. I was football coach for 38 years also, and I got home. I retired, and as soon as I walked in the door, my wife says, you are not going to upset my schedule. You need to do something. So I chose to run for council. I don't know why, but I did. I didn't have anything that other than I just wanted Englewood to continue being a great little town, being a full service town, and that's kind of why I went into that. Now, a kicker on my wife is, and she's a very nice lady. So if I badmouth her too much, don't tell her. But I never owned one of these until I became mayor. As I walked in the first day as being mayor, my wife said, okay, the first 25 calls are on me. you are not going to have any more calls on here. So this is why I have this. So it's kind of fun to get going there. So we really did, my wife and I get along very well. So we actually went on a trip together for the first time in 43 years without grandchildren, without children. And so it's always very nice to do that. I have three daughters. Of course, I'm a football coach. What do I have? Girls. And of course, then I have five grandchildren, and two of the boys actually played football for me because I stayed around long enough and nobody wanted the job at Englewood High School, so it was that job. I will say, Doug has all those accolades, but you understand that the city of Englewood is the most manly city in the state of Colorado, voted. Now, what else would you want other than being known as the most manly city in the state of Colorado? So, no, it was voted. It's actually published that we are. I think they took it off the mayor. I think the mayor was one of those people that they chose that. I'm so excited about the city of Englewood. I truly do love it. I've lived here since 63 years. I've been in Englewood. I was not born in Englewood, but fairly close. And so it is a community of my own heart. I love what we do there. We still are a very small town. You can walk down the streets and people still know you, and they don't throw things at me yet, but they're close. So, but no, I hope not. I hope they don't. So, but it's just one of those towns that you just know it's a small town. We consider ourselves a small town in the metropolitan area, and most people, I mean, you pass through it, 38,000 people every day going down Broadway, and 30-some thousand going down Bellevue, and another 45,000 going down Hamden, and that's not our fault. People keep going from one side of the city to the other side. I wish they would stop and spend money there at Englewood. That would be fine. We have some great developments that I want to talk about later on that the city of Englewood's doing. We have some great economic growth, and we have some great residential, whether it be individual housing or apartments that are going on, and I need your help in some of those areas. I love this. This whole committee is just unbelievable. I think Debbie and all of them hit it correctly. We really do get along. We have a lot of meetings without our city managers, which allows us to do an awful lot of work and not have to worry about what they're going to think. We can't sell the store and we'll be okay. But I truly do enjoy this, and everybody that's sitting on this panel they have been just instrumental in helping me grow. Hopefully I've helped them grow a little bit. And speaking of growing, since I've become mayor, I've gained about 60 pounds. So it's meetings like this, and I love to eat. I love to eat all the time. I love to eat all the bad food. And so, you know, you put me at a meeting like this, and I am in trouble. Probably the most important thing today is I got to meet David's sister today, David Pellegrini's sister over there. And I didn't know who she was, and I got to meet her finally. And so it's so nice to meet her. So thank you again for having me, and hopefully we can get some information from you, but also hopefully we can share information with all of you. Thank you.
What can you tell us about the future or the economic drivers of what's going on in your city? And we can start with anyone who feels comfortable about this.
The economic driver in the city of Englewood is just accelerating so much, and I'm going to give you a couple of facts that kind of attest to this. In 2008, we had $12 million in permits, only $12 million in permits. In 2010, we had about $22 million in permits. In 2012, we had $44 million in permits. This year, in 2013, we started at $250 million in permits, and that is huge for the city of Englewood. We have not done that many permits for probably 10 years, and so it is driving. I think some of the driving forces, we have a new incentive package like most of the cities over here. We try to not sell the city. We want to make sure that we sell the property, that we have some kind of buyback in, that we have some kind of money coming back when we do these incentives. Another driver for us, of course, is the TODs, the transportation part of this whole thing. And we are working on our corridor, the light rail corridor, trying to get different apartments. We're melding and blending different things in, and I'll talk about that, the zoning process of that later. But there's going to be some huge things on that part. One of our goals as City Council this year is to improve the stretch of Broadway from 285 to Bellevue. Now, we have two bookends that are being created at this time. On the north end at 285 and Broadway, we have the old middle school, high school being torn down at this time. If you've driven down Broadway, that'll be a 300 apartments in that complex there. We just got contract, and they just put the fence up yesterday for the south end of Bellevue and Broadway, and we'll have a Sprouts, two new restaurants, and an auto zone. So that will be huge for us. That'll be on the Larry Miller property over there. We're excited about having them in.
Where's that Broadway in
Bellevue? That's Broadway in Bellevue. Okay. The other thing that we have in our planning, and it will be a 15, 20, 25 year, I won't be around, so I won't worry about this, is we're talking about extending Floyd Avenue. Floyd Avenue goes behind City Center, behind Walmart and all those places. Floyd Avenue, we're looking at going underneath the light rail, underneath the railroads, underneath Santa Fe, over Platte River, all the way over to Zuni. We don't do a whole lot with our Northwest Corridor, and so this is a way to open up our Northwest Corridor of the city, because our Northwest Corridor goes all the way to Evans, and we don't do a whole lot, so we would like to open that up and bring people back into the city. So these are plans and dreams, but some of them are already taken care of.
I'm going to run through the economic drivers in the city. American Company, the 300-person engineering firm in town, 200 other locations, CUNY Lexus, Fidelity Call Center, Kaiser Permanente, IT, Rocky Mountain Division, which is in unincorporated Arapahoe County, which will be coming into Greenwood Village, and then also Cool Planet, which has some very interesting potential in creating additives for gasoline and also for water retention in soil, a TOD project called DTC Apartments, which is in easy walking distance of the Orchard Light Rail, some place called Trader Joe's, which you might have heard of.
That's why we got to get Sprouts built first.
And a Westin Hotel, which is in process, redevelopment of Arapahoe Road, and actually there's more going to happen there that Kathy will talk about here in a moment, with a Chick-fil-A, a drive-through Starbucks, which we had a huge traffic jam at yesterday because a certain person going to the Bronco training camp stopped and bought his coffee and gave autographs to Mr. Manning, who lives in Cherry Hills. Yeah, and Doggy Daycare Center, a new Roslyn medical office building right there by Papa Do's. And townhomes, 66 of them, near Yosemite and Cayley, the Century Communities, and a project that'll come before council next Monday, on from the Coble and Company, 346 apartments. The one other thing I'll say is we have banned marijuana, medical marijuana, and retail marijuana, and that's a community value that we feel pretty strongly about. And the other thing we've banned from City Hall, in fact, I just found some in City Hall, and I'm going to throw it out, and this is something you should know, particularly in the building sign, we have banned red tape, so it's gone.
Nice catch.
Was that a setup? Did you know?
Our members are good at handling red tape.
So. Yes. So
well done,
Kathy.
Well done. If I can,
No.
I was just going to follow up a little bit on the residential side, because in terms of economic drivers, obviously what you hear from the other cities is what drives the economic engine in Cherry Hills Village, in terms of the sale of our homes, because the six businesses that we have are leased in the building that is at Lafayette and Old Hampton, and that's where the Caribou Coffee is, and Pino's Pizzeria, and the Vino Vino, and the Salon, and the Cleaners, and South Philly Cheesesteak. But what really drives us is that, and the economic growth relative to other business activity in the surrounding communities and beyond these communities and into Denver as well. The interesting thing, obviously you've all read these articles in the paper about, and the style that they use to describe these are mansions, so mansion homes, but you know, $1 million sales have now doubled since last year. And the tremendous impact that that has had on people like you, with whom I spend a fair amount of time talking about these issues, is incredible. The numbers quoted, and if you go to the Denver Business Journal, they recite that actually Greenwood Village had more of those sales than Cherry Hills, till you dig down into the numbers and realize that a number of the sales are listed as having been in Englewood, which of course is a happenstance of zip code listing. And
I did not create that.
I know. They're actually in Cherry Hills Village, but people will, when they write down 80113, they'll write down Englewood, or they might write down Littleton for 80111. And so as a result, a lot of our sales in the reporting get diffused, and you have to look at the actual street address to realize that we are in Cherry Hills Village, the true economic driver for that. Denver sometimes will outpace us just by virtue of the sheer size of Denver and the fact that there could be more homes, but certainly on a per residence or per dwelling unit basis, we're above everybody else relative to that. So I do know that despite the fact that July is typically a slower month and August is the month everybody says realtors need to go on vacation, because there are no sales in August. Well, I don't believe that personally, but nonetheless, that's the popular lore. I believe that we have seen some pent-up demand finally getting expressed in this marketplace now relative to residential sales, and particularly in terms of what we see in the larger residential sales. So I think there is a lot of hope for that. And again, all credit and kudos to my compatriots on the panel up here for driving the businesses that make that possible, because obviously it's not our very beloved manager at the Caribou Coffee who's buying those houses, but it's all the other people who have put the businesses into these cities.
Time Warner just recently broke ground on a $100 million data center expansion. So Time Warner was in our city, and they're going to be adding this other data center, and it basically will be the West Coast cable head end. We also have the Comcast cable head end, and what we are learning, and something for you all to think about, is this is the climate that these data centers want to be in. Dry air, thin air, easy to cool. That's what they want, and so we are a great place for this, and Centennial seems to have become a data center. We've got, you know, about four companies that pretty much all that goes on in those buildings is a lot of humming and making Excel very happy. So just so you know, that goes on. New tenants coming to South Glen. You probably noticed that there's, you know, some of your favorites may have been leaving. Well, they're not necessarily leaving because of business not being good, as South Glen has now become a hot destination for those nationwide retailers that were not expanding in the years that South Glen opened up. So an Ann Taylor Loft, Chico's, Bath & Body Works, White House Black Market, and Victoria's Secret will join H&M, if you haven't been to the H&M, that's not downtown, Chick-fil-A, and Cafe Rio. And then something that's new to our area is a store called Z Gallery. It's a home furnishings, if you're familiar with it. So we're very excited to have something that, again, that's unique to the area. So South Glen is really doing quite well. We have been studying the I-25 corridor. You know, the city of Centennial looks like, just think of Tennessee. It's kind of long and skinny and has a funny little end on it. So our core is along I-25, And we have been looking at what that might look like in the future. And we did a market study along with Greenwood Village on what is out there, what's the lifespan, will those properties turn over? What we found was a great deal of it would not be turning over. Certain areas might, and there is actually some empty ground there. So we've been planning for what that might look like. And I'll tell you some things that we're doing and then something we're doing in conjunction with Greenwood Village. So the Jones property is the large empty 42 acres that sits between IKEA and the Jones University building, and they have submitted a plan to do over a million square feet of office retail and a little bit of residential. So if you're looking for new things coming, that'll be right there along I-25. I don't know too much about it because it's been submitted, so I'm not allowed to talk about it, but if you have a question, I'd go to our city planning staff. Along with that, in October, Centennial and Greenwood Village are going to be hosting the International Council of Shopping Centers Retail Roadshow. That's a name, isn't it? And we're going to hear the industry experts discuss their vision of what Arapahoe Road from Quebec to Potomac could look like in the future. So we've been studying this way. Now we're going to look this way. So these shopping centers that have been there for a number of years, some have had some turnover. We've gotten some great shops come in there. But what might that look like? What could we make that hub look like? It's key to both of our communities. So together, once again, regional, if it's good for Greenwood Village, it's good for Centennial, it's good for folks driving Arapahoe Road, it's good for all of us. So we'll work on that together. And Arapahoe and I-25, the roadway improvements at that interchange, the I-25 Coalition has been meeting over the years. We go to Washington, D.C., we beg for money, we do all of those things. And we have our environmental assessment completed, so now we're eligible to move forward. So we are designing the first phase, which will actually break ground in 2014, which would be the Yosemite and Arapahoe Road improvements. So they'll be widening Yosemite, so there's more turn lanes to go in either direction. Also some improvements on Arapahoe Road. So we're on our long-term path, and then what came up was CDOT's ramp funding. And so they asked for projects throughout the state that you could do accelerated projects. And we have submitted this project. It's in the final competition for the final list, and it looks very strong. And if that's the case, the entire design and the entire improvements may be moved up by many, many, many years. And it could include a new bridge and then some a great deal of change, actually, to the Greenwood Village northeast corner along where the Pat's Chili Steak and all of that is. So just if people are talking about the congestion there, know that it's being worked on. Something that I can't really tell you what's happening yet, but just know that the former trail dust facility will have something very new and very exciting very soon. So there's another piece. The Greenwood Village had the Restaurant Depot go into the Country Dinner Playhouse, and so the next vacant building happens to, that's where the line is, so to speak, the city line, and that's why we partner. Literally, that's the city line. And so now the trail dust, that property closed last week. So those of you in the industry might be able to find out who bought that.
Well, we have a number of things that are going on in Littleton also, fortunately. So far this year, we've welcomed 47 new businesses, and we have 10 additional businesses that will be opening. They haven't opened yet. And amongst those, we're seeing some of the data stuff that you had talked about, too. And we had a 56,000 square foot office building that had sat vacant for probably over 12 years. And a group came in, they're a restaurant data group. And they bought the whole building. And, oh yeah, I'm sorry, that came from Inglewood.
Do you know how many lunches
see how we share?
Well, and then we also got something from Denver.
Yeah. That's my favorite.
Yeah, Breckenridge Brewery, which that's fantastic. I mean, that's real exciting. That's a landmark business for Littleton, and particularly because that whole industry is the industry of the micro has gotten, you know, turned into a little micro business in terms of tourism and that type of thing. So I think it's going to be, and the council's talked about it on a number of levels, is what that does in terms of kind of spur our thinking into attracting a tourism crowd, which is an excellent crowd. They come, they dump the money, and they go. And so you don't have to provide a bunch of services for them. They just you just provide opportunity to spend. We have also seen a great deal of applicants once the economy started getting better and the money loosened up a bit. We've seen a number of applicants come in for multifamily, and we have not seen anything come in other than that. And part of, and I don't know if we'll get to this or not, I'll go ahead and say it now, but part of what we're dealing with and all of the cities are dealing with is this construction deficit law that's on the books. The brilliance of our state legislators, they pushed it under the rug again last year. I hope we don't let them do that again this year. I think the cities, I know us sitting up here, we're sick to death of it, because all we've got in our pipeline right now are apartments. And God bless apartments, there's nothing wrong with them, but when that's all you've got coming in, your community looks at it and gets very disturbed, and they start to have real issues with councils and planning boards continuing to approve one type of housing. People want more diversity. And a lot of people that are living in our communities don't want to move from them. They want to stay there, but they want to get out of their house and move into something different. And it's, for a lot of them, the apartment is not what that is. So we are, tonight, the city council is having a study session, and we have got a, we had, and I cannot remember her last name, first name, Patty, did so good with names. She did an incredible study for us on Littleton and how that relates to Arapahoe County, Douglas County, Metro Denver, and the housing situation. And we have a incredibly aged stock of single family homes. They were built in the 80s, and that's about the last building that we had done. We have an abundance of multifamily, but we also have the lowest vacancy. So while we have a lot of it, it's filled. So those are, while those are good challenges to have, where you've got people lined up wanting to move into your community and wanting, you know, developers who want to do stuff, we're seeing where a little bit of that kind of is there's a little bit of collision with some of that. We have the Marathon property, which is really in Littleton. There's just two large parcels. Both of them are zoned. The Marathon property was zoned in 2006. And we just had the developer come in. He wanted to tweak it a little bit. It is 900 residential units and 250,000 square feet of commercial. We just approved a tweak on the zoning on that. And so they will get going on that. They're going to probably go with the commercial first. And I didn't realize that that property is larger than the streets of South Glen. So what we do there is going to be very, very important to what the continued health of Littleton is. Because like I said, with just one other parcel, which is the Ensor property, which you probably are familiar with, and that's a little over 100 acres. And they take it, put it on the market, take it off, put it on, take it off, get a cash offer, walk away. So who knows what, if anything, is going to happen there. But along with that, one of the things we're seeing as a huge growth industry in Littleton, and it was kind of just simmering there for a while, and now it's starting to explode, is our medical, and down in the South Park area. And we have got international companies in there, medical device companies, medical research companies, and these types of things. That are growing up out of there. Littleton Hospital is providing a lot of the opportunity for that growth too, because of all the work that they do. CenturyLink, again, they're bringing in about, they won't give us an exact number of employees, but we know it's somewhere around 3,500. And we are now starting to see those employees look for housing in Littleton. A lot of them pulled out of Denver, and so we're starting to see them starting to roost in. I talked to the Littleton Public Schools folks, and they are seeing a lot more of that starting to happen. And that's the other thing. I mean, Littleton Public Schools, there's no denying it's a huge, huge driver for residential, for people wanting to move here, wanting to live here, wanting to be here, and we continue to support that endlessly. Another thing is, and a lot of people don't really think about this, but it's South Platte Park. It's our jewel. It's this massive, wonderful oasis in the middle of this, you know, suburbia. And we are looking at putting a whole lot more money into that park and along the whole stretch. And that's one of the things we do as a region also. Englewood, Sheridan, Columbine Valley, Arapahoe County, we all meet with a group called the South Platte Working Group, and we spend the open space tax dollars buying property and doing things along that river that will enhance it. Our focus over the next probably 3, 4, 5 years on that is what do we do in terms of economic development? How do we build businesses and residential in that area while we still protect the beauty of the river, the those types of things, but we also take advantage of that amenity? Denver is starting to work on it. They've got 22 miles of river to work on. And I don't know, what are we, what's a wrap at 13 miles or something? And that's through three municipalities. So I think Littleton stretches about 6 or 7 miles of river. But that is, I think, a real huge opportunity for us and for the opportunity for to bring in different kinds of interesting businesses and more multi-use type of things. So those are some, all of that is being worked on and all in different stages of happening, so.
Construction defects litigation has been a major topic of discussion with the Metro Mayor's Caucus, as well as with the Denver Regional Council of Governments. And most of us here are the Dr. Cog reps and obviously on the Metro Mayor's Caucus. And I know, Randy, your new development at Kent Place, the stuff that's going in now, that product is all apartments. It's all rental housing. Mm-hmm. And I think, have you got some now that are just the rental that's going in? So we know that's a significant element of what's impacting this market for the larger segments of the market. And at some point, we, and I mean you as brokers, we as elected officials are going to have to sit down and work together to find a solution to the construction defects litigation. And the legislature did punt on it last time, and there is talk that they will come back with another bill in the next session. But a lot of the elected representatives do not seem to have the intestinal fortitude that might be necessary to push that through. And I think that's going to continue to impact all of you as it impacts us.
And let me add to Doug's thing. We had six major developments going into the city of Englewood. Most of them started out, three of them started out as for sale units. They have all gone to, now we have six apartment units going in. We have two more developers looking at General Ironworks, which will look at about 180 townhomes. And then we have a place called Masonic Temple that's looking at probably about 70 townhomes. They're going to test this. I don't know how far they will go with this whole thing, but these would be the biggest for sale units in the city of Englewood since probably the late 60s. But they still have to test this first. So we would love them to go in. We have no idea where they're going to go.
Greenwood Village does not like realtors. We love them. To the point that we've elected one of your own, T.J. Gordon, as a council member. I think now we really understand that you folks are small business and we're, like the other mayors, pro-business. I think what we can do to build a relationship and is information. Something that I have done for an unnamed realtor is actually appear at open houses to answer technical questions on taxes, special districts, so on and so forth. And I also will say we are not only blessed with Littleton Public Schools, but also the Cherry Creek Schools. And you know better than I that that's the number one driver is for people with families to have a great school district. And one other statistic I want to throw out, and then I'll wrap it up, is something that gets overlooked on the apartment side, is that the census in 2010 determined that the Denver metro area had 40.8% of its households were single people. And that's a pretty big number. when you stop and think about it. And that covers elderly, that covers kids coming out of college, and the in-betweens. So that's something to think about when you're doing your marketing. As to what we can do is help you with statistics, keep you current. You know, subscribe. Each city hands out a newsletter on a periodic basis. Subscribe to it. Get to know what's going on. Your local papers, Littleton Crier, Littleton Independent, the Town Crier here, and the Villager newspaper are all good sources of information. And last but not least, all of us answer our phone. And that goes not only for the mayors, but for council people and city staff. This, you know, government is a steward of resources. We understand that business provides the profit and the revenue upon which cities operate, and that we are to be good custodians and guardians of that money. So that's what I would say as to how we can help you and you can help us.
Well, I've actually been down here before and asked for your help, and we'll do it again if it comes to that. But a number of you have come to our council meetings and spoken in favor of some of the developments that we have the council's reviewing. You know, one of the things that a community faces, particularly when you've been stagnant for a number of years, and Littleton has been in terms of development, in terms of things changing over, in terms of building, in terms of new businesses coming in, for a number of years, there was nothing going on. Part of it was the economy, part of it was just messaging that was out there. And I think what we're seeing happen is now that we've got a lot of activity and we've got a lot of interest in the community, we have also kind of woken this sleeping lion of a large portion of our population who just doesn't want to see things change. They don't want to see things go different. And what's really starting to happen more than anything, and I think you have to branch out. You have to look beyond your community to see what is really happening and what is really driving it. And there is a completely different surge of population that's coming up. It's people who don't have this identity with house and home. It is this group that's coming up with this massive college debt that they're paying off and they're having trouble getting financed. It's this group that's coming up who are saying, I have no intention of working for this company longer than 5 years. And so, and they are also the ones that are making six figures. We've got, in Alta Aspen Grove, we've got 3 millionaires that live over there and they work from their home. We had, in our Nevada place, 32 units that were put in, intended to be sale units, turned into rental units because of the market. The average income over there is over $80,000 a year. The average income in Littleton is $56,000 a year. So this, what's coming in is coming in with money. That's what drives our economy. We are sales tax based company. The property taxes don't go to us. They go to our school system, they go to our fire department, they go to our Parks and Rec district. So it is the spending, it is that disposable income, it's the restaurants, the shops, the Trader Joe's. But
remember,
and IKEA. But that's what it takes. And so we need to put density in places that will spur this type of shopping and this type of activity. And when you have a population that doesn't want to see those types of changes and thinks that density brings with it massive amounts of crime and traffic and lower level incomes, shifting that thinking is very, very challenging. And we're dealing with a lot of that right now. And I think that anybody that is watching what's happening across the metropolitan area and seeing, and you listen to Mayor Hancock, we've heard him 1,000 times, this surge of 30-somethings that are seeking out the Denver metro area. It's not just Denver. We are, people don't know when they cross or mingle with the Littleton. They don't know when they cross. So people don't live in those boundaries like we are.
They know if they're going to Cherry Hill
what?
Village.
That's true. And they know when they hit the village.
Doug is standing at the roadway.
Yeah.
Go back.
But
it's the necessity of pulling out a passport usually that slows them down.
Geez.
That's part of it.
Special license plates.
Please, don't quote that. Strike that from the tape.
Yeah. But I think that's part of what we really want from you guys, is that support, is that understanding that, you know, the health of a community has a number of prongs to it. And a healthy community is a community that supports everybody. And turning over these older houses and moving, you know, getting new people in. The biggest complaint I hear about Littleton is that people cannot find a place to live. There's no inventory. And, you know, those are the kind of the challenges we deal with. So we're kind of all in it together. We'll get through challenges and come out and have those successes.
As you may or may not know, sales tax drives the economies of these four cities. That's really what they live on. It's exactly reversed in Cherry Hills Village. About two-thirds of our revenues are property taxes, and one-third relates to sales tax in those six little stores and use tax on vehicles. Thank God people like to drive nice cars in Cherry Hills Village. That helps make up a large portion of that one-third, but it's two-thirds property taxes. So that's why I am very invested in making sure that the value of homes in Cherry Hills Village continues to stay strong and to grow. Because the second there is a downtick in the market, I feel that directly, and I feel it far more significantly even than a city that depends upon sales tax, because there's usually not that same degree of downturn in the sales tax. So it's a very significant thing for us, and that's why we work so diligently in trying to cooperate with realtors in having that message sent out that these are great properties and ones that you want to look at.
What I would like to emphasize for what you all could do, there's a couple things especially, but number one is, well, what you always do is you are a conduit for us for what people want in our communities. So with our aging housing stock, in Centennial's case, it's our aging demographics. 30% of our citizens are over the age of 50. That's very old compared to a Douglas County. So you need to realize that people built these houses and have stayed in these houses, and they're going to all want to move. And we don't want them to all leave our city. So we need a variety of housing stock. We need places for people to go. We actually, on the east side of town, have two new retirement communities opening. One's an assisted living, one's independent with some assisted. That's wonderful for us because we need some place to bring our parents to, perhaps when I need to go and be near my daughter and don't want to live in my house. But we just need different types of housing stock. And so you all need to realize that we have those kinds of demographics. And so at the City of Centennial, we actually have a map, if you want to see it, that we have by precinct the density of the age of the people that live there. And it's very fascinating to see the trend. So if you'd like to see that, come give me your card. I'll make sure I get you a copy of that. But what really you can do, besides some of the things that have been mentioned, is this is the year of local elections, and you really, really need to pay attention, not only to the candidates, but to the issues that are on those ballots. In the City of Centennial, for example, we have a council of 8 and a mayor. We have 4 council members term limited. Absolutely will be gone. So one half of your council will absolutely be new. That's huge. I am rerunning. If I did not win, you would have a majority of your council be brand new. And brand new as in most of them have never even done anything in the city. So what we really would love is to sort of grow our own. Let's start getting people involved in our boards and our commissions, because when people get on council, and usually if they're doing it, there's two reasons. One, I just want to get involved. And somehow they think that's the best place to start. And sometimes that's great, but sometimes it's more than they realize. But the other thing is that a lot of times they have one agenda item. I don't like X. And then they get there and they found out that they didn't have any control over X. You know, when people run for city council in our area and say, I am here for fire and schools, well, that's darn good, because I don't do anything with the schools and I don't do anything with the fire. So you're running for the wrong board. You need to be running for the school board and the fire district board. So it's important to help educate our citizens and each other in how our local government works, because I guarantee those of us up here have the biggest impact on their largest asset, their home, by what I zone an area to be, what I might want to do. And yes, we don't raise taxes without a vote of the people. Absolutely we don't. But we can't, exactly. We absolutely can't do that. And that's great. But realize that if you know, we want the community to thrive. We want to have a balance. And so those are very important. So with that, the one thing I would like as a takeaway that you are going to need to get educated on the ballot for the City of Centennial is this Monday night, it is very likely that you will see a ballot question go on for the City of Centennial for this November to allow the City of Centennial to re-establish the ability to get into the telecommunications business. And by that, it does not mean that the City of Centennial wants to start a cable company. I'm not hiring any cable guys. Not going to do that. But the City of Centennial over the last 5 years has laid a number of miles of fiber throughout the city to run our traffic signals, to put them all into the 21st century and beyond. In all of that fiber, we have massive amounts of capacity that we can now, could perhaps, sell capacity to the providers. There's a law that was passed in 2005 that prohibited cities from doing this. But it also allows you to go to your voters and ask, and we're going to ask. So if someone says, oh, well, the city just wants to, you know, get in the cable business, that's not what we want to do. We don't really have a set business plan because we're not going to spend a lot of money investigating this if we can't do it. But when you look at all this, and people have come to us, some of the providers have come to us and said, can we get some of that fiber? Because it's already there. They wouldn't have to put it in. They need to get it from the main thoroughfare to the home or the business. But we couldn't even have the discussion with them because we're not allowed. And just to give you an idea, what we're looking to be is a gigabit city. And when we've talked to some of our business owners, they've moved here from places like Chattanooga, and the phrase is their internet was ridiculously fast, and now they've moved and opened a business here, and it's not. But just to give the common person that you might be selling a house to, who may want to work from home, exactly what Debbie said, they need these high speeds. With what we're talking about, the capacity of the fiber we have is you could download 5 HD movies simultaneously in 20 seconds. So that's the kind of speed that we're hoping to be able to get through our fiber we have in conjunction with others to every home and every business in our city. So that's my takeaway. If you think that would help you sell a house, help us spread the word.
I want you to know that the brown space available in the City of Englewood is less than 1%. We have nowhere to go except up and or remodel, tear down, and start over. And so that's one of the things that we've tried to instill. We've got some incentives out there for redoing your house, enlarging your house. I mean, a lot of our housing stock was 1 and 2 bedrooms. And so we must improve our housing stock as we go. The City of Englewood last year sold 18 houses. We had a neighborhood stabilization package. We bought 18 houses, sold 18 houses. All of them were no less than 3 bedrooms. So our whole goal is to, number one, get new housing stock for people to move back. And I guess my wish to you is come back and find out what Englewood is about. We have a lot of new things going on. We kept Craig Hospital in our town that wanted to go out to Anschutz. We have a brand new high school being built. We have a new middle school that's going to be renovated. And so our whole educational system is changing in Englewood. And I think you need to know that. The other thing is we have the biggest industrial area in Arapahoe County, the biggest, bar none. And no one knows about it. No one knows about it. We have a fabulous site on our city website called eSites. It's for all the commercial buildings that are for sale in the city of Englewood. It is a huge site. We sell things off of there all the time from, and we don't sell them, but the other people do. But we do that for no charge. And I think that's huge for us. As we continue to upgrade, as we continue to expand, I think you're going to see things in Englewood that you've not seen before. We have in our northeast quadrant, we have houses selling for $500,000. Who would have ever thought you could purchase a house in the city of Englewood for over $500,000? Now, I'm just not talking about one or two. We have over 45 that have sold for $500,000 or more. So I don't know if you've not been in the city of Englewood, you haven't seen what our market is like. I think the other thing is I would like to sit down with any of you that'd like to come and just chat and talk about things that we could do as a city that could improve our real estate market and to also help with the communication. Sometimes I am not a realtor. I will never claim to be a realtor. So I need to learn. And the best thing to learn is listen to the experts. So if you're willing to sit down and chat and talk about what you think is missing in the city of Englewood, what are some of the things, the zoning problems that we have, some of the building ordinances that we have, you need to let us know. And I think you let everybody know on this panel, because that is one thing that, yeah, I can make some decisions, but if I am not very well versed in these decisions, how do I really know that I'm making the correct decision? And I think the last thing is, you know, Englewood is a fantastic place to live. And if you haven't found that out and you haven't driven around the neighborhoods, you haven't rode your bicycle through the neighborhoods, you will find that out. And I think you could do that in all of our communities. I don't think it's just Englewood. And find out what's going on with the people in the city of Englewood and in the rest of the cities here. So thank you. Thank you so much for allowing us to be here.
Thank you.